I will have two hats today. One will be the MSF hat, the second one will be the DNDI one. And they are very close to each other because DNDI and MSF are very close to each other. My declaration of interest, and I'm very proud of this one, is to be working with DNDI and to be working with FARCO to develop a drug combination of sofosbuvir and ravidasvir, which is now being developed in a very large bunch of clinical trials in Egypt, in South Africa, in Ukraine, in Vietnam, Thailand, and Malaysia, to really assess the safety efficacy of a pangenotypic treatment regimen at low cost for other territories than the usual ones. DNDI has been created by MSF the Nobel Prize money, to try to figure out solutions for neglected disease and neglected people. So the disease nobody cares about, or people nobody cares about. And in a very strange way, hepatitis C belongs also to the neglected people, notably poor people in middle income or people in high income countries. Now, I said, well, this is a very difficult presentation. There is nothing new. I could have told you taken a presentation for 2012 and give it today, it would have been exactly and cynically the same. So let's try now to be very pragmatic in addressing some of the things that bother us when we try to implement operations these days. And we will take them a little bit one after the other. We have troubles with ORACQUIC. ORACQUIC is the only rapid test MSF is allowed to use in resource-limited settings. But these are data from our screening efforts across several countries and several projects that are interconnected in a multicentric prospective cohort study manner. And if you look at the results we have, you understand immediately, for example, in the African cohort, HIV cohort within the UNITAID grant, that we absolutely need to screen a huge number of people to find some people co-infected with hepatitis C. And it represents very early a huge amount of money and a problem for our bosses, the heads of operations, because they tell us immediately, well, guys, I mean, is it worth this effort? So it's a very cynical approach again, but the lack of effectiveness of the tools we have for screening is a problem for the operations. And the positivity, I'm sorry, I cannot read the slide myself, so I will go this side. You see that we had in Kenya, for example, to screen more than 4,000 people to identify 10 people with a positive RDT, and two of them had a positive viral load. In Mozambique, we screened among very complex groups, and people living with HIV, MDR, TB, TB, and we found people when we started screening within the drug user community itself, when we went really to the point where we went to the streets, where the drug users were, in the clinical centers where they were, and then we found, and among the 30 people identified, half of them are drug users. And we are starting the first patient on treatment this Monday, which has been the result of 2 years of efforts to reach the point. In Uganda, we had also to screen more than 7,000 people to find 18 people with a positive serology and 5 with a viral load. So I'm not telling you that it's not worth doing it. Not at all, but it means a lot of efforts and it means a lot of consistency. If we look in Asia and Middle East, this is again among the HIV cohorts, we see a much higher prevalence and a much higher concordance, I would say, between the serology and the viral load. In Phnom Penh, we have 4% of confirmed hepatitis C serology, 7% in India, 6% in Rangoon, 8% in Dawei in the south. In Myanmar, we had It's a hidden epidemic, but if we look at across four huge HIV cohorts we have 14% of co-infection HIV hep C and 9% co-infection HIV hep B. And in the northern part of Myanmar, we are doing exploratory missions where 85% of men take drugs, for example. This means that we know already that the hepatitis C is in the community and not addressed at all. So there are countries where it has to be addressed in a very fast way, I would say, at national level. Come back to Iraq a minute, because this is the one we are with MSF using, but this one is expensive. If you consider that it's $14 a test, and even with food procurement, you get it at $7. And if you add to that you have 25% false negative results among HIV positive people, and you cannot rely on the test if the CD4 counts are very low, you start to add a lot of barriers, a lot of troubles, which are not small troubles. If you consider that we have screened 40,000 people in Myanmar and that we have to factor 25% of false negative results, what are we doing now? And again, we don't have yet the tools. They are not good enough. That's all what I can say. And if we consider how fast we have gone on the treatment side, and how slow we are on the diagnosis side, then the discrepancy is a problem. It is a problem for any scaling up in low and middle income countries. If we look at the WHO pre-qualification, we addressed the issue a little bit with Gottfried yesterday, and Manal told it very clearly, the process is far too slow, and this process may not be adequate. If on one side you have Rosanna Pilling telling you there are plenty of very good tests below $2, and on the other side you don't have one single rapid diagnosis test in 2010 in the WHO pre-qualification list, what are we doing with that? What is the solution? We have to be more pragmatic than that, and I hope that FINE can help on this, to fasten another way to make rapid diagnostic tests available. How do we give incentive to the manufacturers to make their tests and publish documentation of the tests so that we can address them? We have to do it another way. This one is far, far, far too slow. And there are other hurdles. The quality of the tests, not only that they are not WHO pre-qualified, but not tested on HIV people most of the time, that you can have cross reaction, that we don't have quality control. On the quality of the LDTs, on the process for viral loads, and for genotyping. In Myanmar, for example, we started genotyping in the best possible lab in the country. And to be sure, we sent some samples to Geneva. And then we had confusions between genotype 1 and 3. Between 1 and 6 and 3 and 6. When you start, when you have no data in one country, you cannot make a mistake on your genotypes, especially if you want to assess treatment response with specific treatments. So once again, and it's the same thing with genotype 5, for example, in South Africa, and the genotype 6 is all except 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, so it's a very complex, in fact, it's very complex in detection. In Geneva, they had to do a specific PCR for us for the genotype 6. So this one is a question. The second, the viral load. First, you can send all your samples to a central lab. Fair enough. But if you are in the middle of nowhere, it means that you have to ship frozen plasma, and your cold chain has to be consistent at all steps, and this is not an easy thing at all. So of course, if we can do everything using DBS, it changes our life. And if you can have the DBS, the GeneXpert, it makes a point of clinic test at least, and it's much better. But even this one, last week they told me in Myanmar, you know, among 2,070 people, we have 70 who have spontaneously cleared. What is that? 70 people spontaneously cleared, what is that? It's probably a mistake again with the lab. And these are new technologies. So we have constantly to be vigilant. And each additional test is also an additional problem that you have to monitor adequately. So really, the screening confirmation process is not fit for purpose, is not fit for scaling up. We have really to change that. The core antigen, we speak about it a lot, and the core antigen could be a summary of the screening confirmation process, but it's not a proof of cure. It goes back to the question we had yesterday. Do we need a proof of cure? We may still need it now, but we have to remove this in the future. It's not a mystery. Already in Egypt, they tell us, and we have to respect it's real life, that 45% of the 24 SVR12 results are not back. It's exactly the same in Mongolia, and this is what we will see as soon as we scale up. So this has to be factored in the equation now in terms of quality of the care package so that we remove the need, unless we have specific populations that need proper screening following treatment, we have to be able to remove this. The dry blood spot is a very good tool and so useful, so much easier to treat, but again, there are some limits. Can we use a dry blood spot on the GeneXpert Hep C for proof of cure or not? We already know that it's not okay for the core antigen as a proof of cure, but more work is needed. This is something where FIND has a role probably to play in addressing these missing pieces of evidence so that we can move forward. The hepatitis C viral load, could we do one and one only? And how much could we remove the ORAQUIC and do one viral load only? If an ORAQUIC is $7 and the cartridge for viral load 14, we prefer invest one, 14, and get an answer. But also the GeneXpert has not been validated on genotypes 5 and 6, for example. Are we sure? Is it fine? This is also something that we can really address. The liver fibrosis assessment, this one is really careful, needs to be done very, very well. As long as the assessment conditions the duration of treatment, it has to be very, very good. I mean, we cannot make a mistake there. And we are not sure in co-infected people. And we know that the scaling up of the FibroScan is not an easy, is not something that will happen easily in resource-limited settings. And the FibroScan is not validated for children, is not validated for pregnant women, and this is a problem in case of hepatitis B, PMTCT. So I don't have the answer yet, but are we sure that we can use APRI as a single marker for liver fibrosis assessment? Is it solid enough in all populations? It's a question I don't have the answer, but we need this answer because all the guidelines are based on this one more than on the FibroScan, and the wording is complex. There are two cutoffs. How do the people understand the cutoff? Which cutoff do they implement? Is it the magic bullet, APRI above 2, you treat? Because this is the only answer you get with an APRI, yeah? Below, above 2. So what will the people do? If they do an APRI, do they put on waiting list all those below 2 and treat only the other ones or not? We are not yet completely... we need to provide a better answer there. Genotype 3 people, if you look at the new guidelines, these people require even more care and more attention than before. If you treat them with sofosbuvir, daclatasvir, you need 24 weeks and ribavirin, if they are cirrhotic or experienced. If you take sof-vel, you need to add ribavirin to some patients. And you need to take care, potentially, of the baseline polymorphisms. So we are not yet... And I hope we will be soon, at least, in a setup where genotype is no more important. We are not yet there. We should get to that point. But right now, unless we decide to treat everybody less, like the most difficult to treat, but this means that you treat longer people who don't need, for example. Otherwise, we still, at that point, need genotype, and genotype is not available in many countries or not reliable. Of course, there are other monitoring questions like, as we mentioned before, ribavirin and longer treatment durations. How do you manage treatment interruptions? These are also things that will come in real life. So, in terms of algorithms, do you need really to add an electrocardiogram at baseline everywhere if you consider using sofosbuvir, or do you simply monitor bradycardia? And when do you reach the point where you decide to use DAAs without any monitoring for non-cirrhotic people? And how long will the NS5A baseline RAS not matter? I don't have the answer. But from the clinical trial and from the prevalence of these baseline RAS in the general populations, at least of treatment-experienced people like in this study, it seems that there is an issue that we may not measure very well at that point, but how long will we have to do without? And when do we have to factor this in this equation again for resource-limited settings? And then this slide, I inserted it in 2012 with MSF. And 4 years after, we are exactly at the same point. And this is a shame. We don't have any point of care e-antigen testing. We don't have any point of care hepatitis B viral load. We don't have any screening for hepatitis D. The only thing we have is the HBS antigen testing. That's all. And that's all we have, and we have to do with that. So as long as you ask us to do more, somehow we can decide to be stuck, or we can decide to go further. An example, in Mozambique, we have 9% of prevalence of hepatitis B in the general population. We have a very good HIV PMTCT structure. The question is, how do we better use existing infrastructure to propose to the ladies not only a screening for HIV, but also for hepatitis B and hepatitis C, and appropriate care for each disease? Fair enough, but if I follow the guidelines, I need e-antigen testing, I need hepatitis B viral load. And only those with high viral load or e-antigen positive to be treated. But I don't have the test. So should I wait 10 years to get this, or should I do something without? And the decision will be to do without. And to follow the lady and the child for 2 years, to propose tenofovir during the end of the pregnancy and the peripartum phase, and vaccinate the child and follow them for 2 years and look at the outcomes in real life. It's a caricature, but it's also this kind of program that, at the end of the day, will be feasible in resource-limited settings, knowing that some questions will be hard to answer. Who should start, and do we start all the ladies only on an S antigen-positive serology? How do you stop? And how do you monitor after? So these are questions that we are thinking about, and we are preparing the protocols now. I want to thank a lot of people, the patients, the FARCO group, the DNDi staff, and the huge MSF staff, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Isabel. All the points are well taken by Fine. Is there any question from the floor?
Just thanks for the presentation, Isabel. Great, as always. With APRI, to use a threshold of 2, to me, seems pretty high, especially if that's your threshold for treatment. I guess what I might think about doing is using a lower threshold, like 1, and then thinking about, if you're thinking about getting rid of SVR confirmation in the patients that start out with an APRI below 1, that might be a group where you could consider doing that. And I guess I'm wondering if you have thought of doing any studies in that population if you can show your effectiveness in a real-world study is 98 or 99%, like it is in clinical trials, in a non-cirrhotic population, then maybe you don't need to do SVR12 confirmation in low-risk patients.
So we are really documenting this very carefully, in fact, because, as you said, the APRI above 2 wasn't good for us, and we decided to prepare treatment for treatment above 1 as a APRI cutoff in our settings, as we can afford it. But this was my point. I also agree with you that above 2 is very extreme, and it's not the best we can propose to people, probably. But this is the true performance of APRI, in fact. It gives you cirrhotic or not, I would say. And that's why we need more specifics around this recommendation. But this is something that we are documenting within the MSF prospective cohort study. Yeah.
It's quite impressive to see the kind of problems you are facing everywhere in the complexity. But still, you also want to do things, right? So I was wondering, how do you dissolve this dilemma? And I think one of the guiding principles maybe that you, the one thing you don't want to do is cause harm, right? So I'm just curious how you solve the issues.
So when we have a question and we don't have the answer, we try to find, either we can do it ourselves with our partners, or we try to put the question here also to pick. We know good brains will also try to pick the question. But for example, the question of the correlation a pre-fibroscan is something that we are studying within the MSF Epicentre network. The correlation, the threshold to start APRI, we will have also to be readdressed. With FIND in Malaysia, we will have a joint exploration very soon to look at how we can prepare the tools for a scaling up of screening and treatment programs, and how we can do the best within the huge United FIND framework in terms of moving forward the core antigen testing agenda, moving forward the point of care viral load, in terms of field assessment and what kind of performance we get with that.
Initiation threshold, because in many projects we work for, like in Pakistan, in Karachi, we get our initiation threshold down, and basically what we aim in eliminating any need for initiation threshold. We treat everyone who is confirmed with HCV. What the next challenge would be is to have something validated better for cirrhosis threshold. So we need to identify people who need, for instance, in Pakistan, we have 90% of our patients have genotype 3, which is, with the soft duck is a specific challenge. So we try to treat everyone, and the drugs becoming more and more accessible there, it's fine. But now we need to identify those who will need different treatment for. That's a challenge probably.
There are other programs where we go for test and treat without waiting anything, and other programs where we have such a huge waiting list of patients advanced already that we need to treat them first, and then we will go back into the treatment eligibility criteria.
Thank you, Isabel. Now, in the interest of time, I would like to...